I'm going to talk about how some of the things are changing with regard to maths in context, in particular, what we are trying to do in integrating Unicode and OpenType math features and getting them in context. So there are two ways to look at Unicode math. One is what I'm calling in the traditional text sense, that we type in what Unicode specifies as Greek alpha, Greek beta, Greek gamma, which are more accessible by keyboard shortcuts. We type them within the math mode, and we expect math, italic, alpha, beta, and gamma to come out. We expect these letters to behave just like normal letters. So if I type x underscore alpha, I should get x underscore alpha. I should not have to enclose this in within parentheses, because I don't have to do that if I replace alpha by a. All characters should be equal in that regard. And I should be able to type summation symbol, product symbol, basically any Unicode symbol, and get the output. So the other way to look at it is in the Unicode sense. And Unicode specifies that this code point is math italic alpha. So if I want math italic alpha, I should be able to type in this into my editor and get math italic alpha. Similarly, there are code points for italic math, sans serif math, bold italic math, and few other font styles. So if we want, we should be able to type in those correct Unicode symbols and get that without any font switches, so to say. Now, this is something which currently works in context, both for traditional tech engines as well as for Unicode math. And I'm just going to give an example here. So this is a file which I have an option of either loading Cambria math font or not. And if I don't load Cambria, then Latin Modern would be used by default. And I have ignored all these formattings. This is just so that I get a typed page. I have typed alpha, beta, gamma, and these are the usual things. So if you look here at the bottom, this says this is alpha with a hex code of 03BA, so this is Greek alpha and not math italic alpha. And so when I typeset it, this is what I get. So this was the same things that I had input, and I get the correct output here. And this is Latin Modern math. I can do the same thing with Cambria. And now I get Cambria math with the same things. So this is inputting in a traditional text sense Unicode letters and getting the expected output. We can also input the Unicode range, and you don't see anything here because the font that I'm using for the terminal does not have this. In fact, I could not find any monospaced font which provided math alphabets. And so I don't know whether someone would type in these things, but maybe in an automated workflow, one may want to do that. And just to be sure that I'm not cheating, this thing is what I write there it is. And so this is with Computer Modern. I get the correct three digits here. And notice this is math italic A, this is sans serif math A, and this is bold italic A. And I can do the same thing with Cambria, and I get the correct things. Now, what is interesting to note here is that Cambria is a Unicode math font, while Latin Modern right now does not have a Unicode math font. So I'm going to explain how we are dealing with these two different things in context. So basically, I'm giving give a very simplified view of how context read files. So the engine does not understand any input format. So at the macro level, context assumes that the input is in Unicode, reads the file line by line, and does character combining according to Unicode. And if the user specifies another input encoding, then it reads everything and then converts everything internally to Unicode on the fly. And font handling is, I don't really understand that. All I understand is that it can read type 1 AFM fonts, TrueType, and OpenType fonts, and you can create virtual fonts on the fly. And I don't know the internals of how these things happen, but they do.
I have a question.
Yes.
I don't know whether you can answer, but still it's a question. Suppose I want to create a strange thing. Suppose I want to create a font where I would have letter from font A and all digits from font B, so
yes.
It would be complex. Can you do this on the fly?
Yes, we do that for math letters, because Latin Modern does not have everything in a single font.
So we do
that for math, and you can, in principle, I don't think the existing mechanism is kind of fine-tuned to the way traditional tech fonts are to create virtual math fonts, but it's straightforward to adapt it if you want just a part of from one font and part from the other.
Mm-hmm.
So what we need to do is somehow connect what the user has typed into the correct glyph on the font. Now, you need to do that for text, and again, I don't really understand what happens in text. You do need to do that in math, and I vaguely understand what happens in math, and I'm going to explain what I understand, and I hope that everyone can get this even without knowing how the backend works, because in some sense that is not important. You can abstract out all the details to a layer where you don't really care about what engine is doing. So the approach is to map all input bytes to Unicode characters. And this is done mainly by a Lua table, which is called character-def.lua. And there are some other characters in private slots, and there are some auxiliary files to this, but this is the main thing. And then we need to map a Unicode character to the correct location in the font. And for OpenType math fonts, you don't need to do anything, because we assume that the font is an open type font, so the location of the glyph should be at the Unicode character. So that mapping is already done. We need to do some extra work for traditional tech fonts, because we need to create a virtual open type font. Now, to input math bytes to Unicode character, as I said, this is the main file. This is huge. This is almost 150,000 lines of code. A lot of this was done by Hans using Unicode tables and doing automatic generation of this file. And then there has been a lot of work in trying to complete this, because the Unicode tables do not have what context calls, context name for different glyphs, math name for different glyphs, and so on. And I'm going to show how some of this looks like. So for a simple letter like A, we have an entry in a Lua table, which looks something like this. The Adobe name of the character is this. There is a correct category and something to do with CGK, and what is the Unicode description, what is the direction, what is the lower code, and for uppercase characters there's an UC code. What about line breaks here? What about math classes, and what's the Unicode slot number? So this is relatively straightforward. There are things like accented characters where we have a new field which is context name, because if you do not want to actually type the Unicode the accented character, you can type slash a acute and get a acute. There are some hooks if you want to build this thing on the fly by using A and the Unicode accent for acute, and rest of it is almost same as the previous one. There are some characters which are used in text as well as math, for example, backslash. So for that, we give a context name as text backslash and a math name as backslash. And for each math character, we need to specify what math class it belongs to. And instead of using the numbers which Knut uses for tech, we are giving it more easy to remember names. So this is just a math class equal to nothing. So this is the information for backslash. There are things which are more complicated. For example, the vertical bar, which in text is just a single character, but in math can mean a lot of different things depending on what you want to use. So we have a table for that. So it can be an arrow word, which is of class nothing. It can be word, which is a delimiter. It can be L word or R word, which are open and close, or it could be mid, which is a relation. So all this thing needs to be put in, and what we are doing on the fly is that if you get this control sequence L word, there is a lookup which happens, and it says that it has to be of this class, and this is the glyph that we need to pick up from the font. There are things for Greek letters. So this is the text Greek area in Unicode. And for this, we have something like this. And basically just the context name. And notice that we are not setting the math class or math name here, because according to Unicode spec, this is not math alpha. This is text alpha. There is math Greek range, where we do not set the context name, but we set the math class and math name. And similarly for math Latin characters, for capital A, we did not set any math class. For this, we need to do. And so there is different thing for bold and sans serif. And so this, all this data is there in this file. And I'll just, to give an idea, show this file. So this is what the file looks like. And we have all these tables. And as you can see, this is these many lines. And the good thing here is, even though creating it was a bit tedious, that now everything is in the form of a Lua table. So post-processing it is easy. Whatever we want to do with it is just a matter of loading this table and doing some simple manipulations on it. So the way we process the data, at least for math, is we need to somehow construct underlying Lua level commands to tell what each character is. And as I said earlier, there was these easy to pronounce names given to different math classes, and we have in the file math ini, we have something on what is the number corresponding to each math class. And then there are simple functions, like if you want to define something which is a del code, which is from this target, this family, and this slot, and basically load that, and this is the underlying tech command which would be run. And then these type of, there are a lot of these functions for each math class, basically, and then they are run for all math characters in the alphabet. There are things which are math symbols, which means anything which is a command name in math, and then we need to check what the class is, and depending on the class, define an appropriate underlying tech command for that command. So this is like unexpended is a context way of saying a protected macro, basically, in LaTeX, and I don't know what's the equivalent in plain tech, but this is how it is done for symbols. The thing is, and this is what happened when we were discussing it over the mailing list, Moifta actually shouted that you want me to type this to get alpha. This is this is not going to happen. So what we need to do is for the user to still be able to use traditional tech type of input, we need to, when we are in math mode, map all the Latin and Greek input to their appropriate Unicode range. And this is done in math map file. And this is, again, a big Lua table which looks like this. So we have a table called mathematics.alphabets for the regular font, the TF range, all the digits are something starting from this point, the uppercase letters are from this point, lowercase letters are from this point, and symbols are from this point. So this is if you want a normal text font here. If you want an italic font, the uppercase letters start from this point, which is the appropriate Unicode range for math italic. Lowercase letters, this is places where Unicode gets a bit quirky because they decided that since lowercase h is also Planck constant, we are not going to repeat it here again, so Unicode does not map it back, so one needs to actually manually enter the whole table. This could be done slightly more efficiently, but Unicode has these gaps in a lot of places. And basically what this is saying is that if we are in italic mode and the user types this UTF character, this is the location in the font that he should get. So this is what's happening behind the scenes when these things are tied up. And so I showed what looks for text font, italic font. Similarly, we have tables for bold italic and bold font. And this was for regular face. We have this for different kind of math faces. And then everything is built together using a simple Lua function, which goes over everything, checks what's the character class of it, and how it needs to be mapped to which thing. So the other thing with math is that to get correct subscripts and superscripts, we need kerning information. And we are looking at how Cambria Math is doing it, and it has it has a different model than text model. It allows for a glyph to have what I think is called a ladder that you can have different places where you want to put the subscript rather than just a box model of text. And from what I understand, Context tries to read this information from the font and tries to do kerning of subscripts and superscript based on these information. And these two pages are taken from the mk.pdf document, which is kind of a running history of LuaTeX, which Hans mentioned. And so here is an example of how Latin Modern does it, and how would Cambria do subscripts and superscripts if we did not use the correct kerning, and what happens if the correct kerning is used.
Could you increase it a little bit?
For some reason, this does not like this. Okay, so how do we actually use an OpenType math font in Context? So Context does provide inbuilt support for Cambria. So if you want to use Cambria, it is as simple as adding two lines into your document. Use TypeScript Cambria, set up body font Cambria, and you get something in Cambria. If you want to use Asana Math, which is another Unicode OpenType math font, which is compatible with Palatino, Context does not provide support for this. So this kind of shows the how much work you need to do to enable an OpenType math font. And what we need to do, the thing which is different, is we need to define a math TypeScript, which is saying that we want features which are math and math at that particular size that we are using the font at. And once we have this, we can define a TypeScript for Asana just as normal TypeScript for other context fonts. And the text part is same as before, and there is very minor change in the way the math font is loaded, and the main thing is done by the TypeScript here. And then you could just do use TypeScript Asana and set up type body font to Asana and use Asana in your document. Now, to give an example, so I have this is the slightly modified version of the test math document from AMS done in Cambria. And I needed to change the input a little bit to run it in context, and I really did not work to make it look exactly like AMS math. So this is the default context output, and I have replaced all the headings and things here. And this is how it looks in Cambria. We can also see how this runs in Asana math. So this is how it looks in Asana. And just to get a comparison with, so this needs to be refreshed. So this is in Asana, and this is the file downloaded from AMS's website, which is in Computer Modern. Now, there are no other open type math fonts yet, so this is all we can experiment with. And so next thing you may want to know is, what about traditional text fonts? Because you may not want to use the text font comparable to either Cambria or Palatino in your main document. So how do you use a traditional text font? So what we need to do is create a virtual font on the fly. And this is the code needed to create a virtual font for Latin Modern at size 10. And all we are doing is saying which of the TFM file corresponds to a math vector. And I'll explain in a moment how these math vectors are defined. And if the font is italic, we need to know what the skew character is and whether extension is enabled or not. And this is basically just putting together all the math fonts that are there and telling context where to pick different lists from. So this partially answers your question as to how this is done. So you can look at the definition of this function, and I think this is in math-vfu.lua, and how this function is defined. And
usually when you do this thing, what you do one font, then delete some characters and add another font. So you need some.
So that's
some,
what
some more granularity.
That's what's happening internally.
Yeah.
So the first this thing is done, then this thing is done, and so on.
Uh-huh.
So it's done in the order in which this Lua table is given.
You can this vector make you can make custom vector.
Yes. I'm going to show the vectors in a moment.
Now I
understand. So these vectors are just these tables, which consists of this input location, which is Greek capital gamma, is located at this location in the font. This Unicode character is located at this location, and so on for a whole bunch of things and for a whole bunch of vectors.
Yeah. You can do full wizardry with this.
Yes.
Yeah, it's enough.
So a lot of times when you are playing around with this, we need to check did everything come right or not. And just using the document that you are working on is not always the best way. So we need certain ways to test these things. And one way to test is to view the entire font. So there is a module in context called font10, which provides a function just to typeset the entire font. And and this is how this thing looks like. So this is the function basically just reads the entire font. There was all this information in the Lua table, so it's just typing it out so that we can read it in a file. And this is a file with about 75 pages because all Unicode characters which are present in Camry are listed here. And there are the glyph is shown, what the glyph's name, the Adobe name for the glyph, and what's the context name if we have given anything. So for something like percent, there is percent. For math things, it's preceded by M colon something, and this goes on for all characters that are there in Cambria. And you can do similar things for virtual fonts which are created just to check how complete the mapping is and whether all the mappings are done correct or not. And sometimes these things are not enough because you don't really see everything in a lot of detail here. So there are other ways of, Hans mentioned a bit about tracing. And this is one thing, one way in which tracing is done. There are simple hooks to enable or disable tracing. And this thing which you don't see here is actually the correct Unicode slot for math italic lowercase a. Rest of it is as it is typed. And the colors basically show what is happening. So green is everything which was available in the font. This dark yellow is something which needed to be substituted. So for example, B, this was normal text B, and context on the fly substituted it with the math italic B. So this is coming out in a different color. Similarly, gamma is coming out in a different color. The delimiters are coming out in different color, just to know how complete the font was and where fallbacks are being used to know what things are missing in the font. There are other ways of tracing because this is not the only thing we care about in a math font. We want to know, for example, if something like this, what would happen if this thing is used in a display mode? Usually you get a different symbol for extensible math symbols. And there's another command for this which would show what's the dimensions of this symbol, what's its math class, what's its math name, and what would be the next thing that would come. There are things for which the next thing is more complicated, for example, a curly brace. And again, this thing gives you different sizes in which curly brace is available, what are the Unicode slots in which they are. And then you see here, this is getting split into all the parts that are needed to build big brace when you are at that size. So all this information is accessible. Yeah.
These are values from private user area, right?
Yes.
How did you decide what to use?
So just ad hoc, we don't know at this stage whether there is some sort of uniformity on how these things should be done. So right now we are just doing it.
I think Cambria did it in a different way, though I don't know exactly.
So for most of the part, if something is available in Cambria, we are following it. But we don't know whether other open type math fonts are going to follow Cambria or not, because the specification leaves this open. And this is one thing which I'm hoping that all font developers come up to a uniform thing on where these things should be. Yes.
Don't hope. Demand.
I think Cambria doesn't do it differently. It doesn't do it the same way. It's just slots in the font.
Yeah, it
does.
I don't know whether these are in the font or these. I think these are in the private area, even in Cambria. So
they shouldn't be encoded anywhere in Unicode.
Right.
They exist as glyphs in the font.
Yeah,
they should.
Glyph numbers, yeah.
They don't have character numbers at all.
Okay.
Yeah, but to access them, it deviates with the numbers by the user.
No, it's not needed. You go through open type tables that go by glyph IDs.
So I don't know how Context is doing it internally. Does it?
How else would you say you want it to use?
No. They depend.
They're accessed through open type tables work on glyph IDs.
The open type table gives you basically the linked list of these things.
Right, yeah.
And it doesn't matter what number they have, you never access them directly.
Yeah, I understand that thing.
Is there an initialization problem? It means that up to now, I understand that you change the font like a quantum mapping or write that.
Yes.
Then maybe there, if I change the mass font, spacing is also makes some.
So spacing rules, we if we know the math class, a lot of the spacing rules can be worked out. So we have the math class information explicitly for each symbol. So the spacing within the math symbols depends on that. And for subscripts and superscripts, Cambria has some spacing information about how kerning should be done, which I showed earlier. But a lot of these things are.
You mean the spacing information is included in OpenType fonts?
For subscripts and superscripts, they are included in Cambria. For other fonts, I don't know. But spacing between characters in math also depends on, it can be configured. Right now, we are just using some defaults as to what should be the spacing between, say, two characters which are math odd. So something like that is still configurable here, and I don't know what really OpenType provides. I don't know that.
OpenType has actually more parameters than TypeScript. So in LuaTeX, we just support everything that OpenType has. So the math engine is extended to do that. And for computer model, or letter model, so you just have to.
But OpenType doesn't support the math class.
In Ulrich's paper, there were a couple math, tech math parameters which aren't in OpenType.
There's a detailed article by Ulrich.
Yeah, that's what I'm.
That's the ultimate resource.
Right.
Okay, so
kerning in math then within OpenType.
It has its own kerning tables.
But does it handle like the upright characters symbols, say
yeah,
H and italic that are very
italic corrections, things like that.
Okay, so where are we right now in terms of context? So we can, if there is a complete Unicode math font, context can handle it. Easily, there aren't too many complete Unicode math fonts. If the font is incomplete, we are still working on what's the right way to substitute using traditional tech definition to make the glyph on the fly. It's just a matter of having the right interface to how to input it. The technical part of it is not that difficult. And traditional tech font work, and about 98% of AMF symbols are math. And Barbara just told me that AMF actually has a list of what names they would give to most symbols in the Unicode symbol list. So we can just borrow from here, from there to do that. So far, we were just looking at what different math, what different packages in LaTeX provide, and some of those are conflicting, and it's not easy to come up with the right name for a math character. Mm-hmm. And my wish list is that there were more math Unicode fonts. I don't know what's the thing with the Unicode math font. They announce when they're going to be released, and they're never released at that date. Minion Pro Math said, I think first it said February, then it moved on to April, and it's much past April. Stix has been going on for quite a while now, but the fonts are never released, so it's not easy to test. Yeah.
I can tell one reason, one thing that's holding it up a bit, and that is that a number of the symbols that had to go into the private use area, Unicode has decided that they will put them into Unicode, and the codes are being finalized, and when those are finalized, the font, the ones have to be moved around in the fonts.
Yeah. Okay.
Is it a commercial font? Cambria?
Yeah, Cambria is Microsoft's font for Office 2007, I think.
Is it included in MS Office?
I don't know.
If you download the Word viewer, you get it.
Download what?
Just a Word viewer.
Word viewer.
Word. There's a viewer for Word. If you download that, you get the real Cambria. Otherwise, your operating system ships with just the text files.
The next person we are using here in MathBowl.
And what we need to do, I think, is have a consistent naming for at least all characters which are, all math characters which are in Unicode, so that this is not something which everyone who needs to use the symbol needs to come up with a name on his or own. That's just not going to work in the long term. And the thing which context does provide to a large extent now is this file format with all the information which is needed to process this. And I wish this was something which could be shared by different engines so that we only need to maintain one database of these mappings from Glyph's name to different names. And as this is a Lua table, it's easy to add if, for example, there were fields which were context specific. If another macro package wants a field which is specific to them, that can be added, and different packages can just ignore each other's field. But there is a lot of shared information which can be worked on together here. And Unicode does not cover all math characters, and we need to have a consistent thing for naming glyphs in the private field. So that's it. Thanks.
Do we have time for a couple of questions more?
Yes.
I didn't understand your comment about having a common file format.
So, for example, JTAG does something with math to map everything to the proper. For each thing, we need to map a command name to the underlying tech command, which sets the math character or the corresponding thing. And the way I understood it, JTAG packages were doing it were having this big list of just declare math symbol, something is something.
So I meant file format. I mean, the list of these things have been
around. So this is a Lua. So I meant that it's better to have all of this as a Lua table, which can be post-processed easily, than have it as a. Yeah, so this is my wish list. I'm not saying you have to follow this. This is my wish list.
What I'm saying is you didn't adopt other people's file format. Why you?
Yeah, because processing it is.
Yours.
Yeah, processing something which is as a tech input is much harder than processing a Lua table.
Oh, definitely.
So that's why, that's the reason. If we wanted to complete.
Backslash is very, very hard.
It's not just one thing. There are multiple parameters here. If this were inputted as a tech macro.
There are multiple parameters in the LaTeX. They're just delimited by tracing.
But LaTeX does not have all this information to Unicode characters right now. But if I had to do it.
I don't mind using your file format. I'm just saying don't insist that people use yours. We've been spent the last 10 years creating our own, that's all.
Yeah, okay.
Anything else?
Just a quick think about this ladder-like subscripts. If you do it, I think you already have, but you need to keep it a possibility to switch it off. And the reason
yes.
is that for many, especially like in tensor algebra, you need to raise and lower your
yeah.
indices. And if you do it in a ladder way, you're going to confuse people mildly.
Yeah. So that is currently possible because this is,
yeah.
From what I understand, implemented as kerning, and it can be disabled or enabled as an open type
yeah.
feature. So you can disable it if you want to.
Yeah. So please keep this.
Yeah. So everything right now is something which can be configured easily. Nothing is hardwired into the engine. So these things can be disabled or enabled on the fly also.
Let's say thank you one more time.